Hachette Audio presents Left Behind, The Democrats' Failed Attempt to Solve Inequality. Written by Lily Geismer. Read by Christine Lakin. Dedication. For Michael, Gabriel, and June. Introduction. Doing well by doing good. On a steamy day in July 1999, President Bill Clinton rested in a plastic lawn chair in front of a ramshackle prefabricated home in the Whispering Pines Trailer Park in Tyner, Kentucky. The economically depressed coal town lay deep in the Appalachian Mountains. While drinking from a can of Mountain Dew, Clinton talked with 69-year-old Ray Pennington, a self-described old-timer with severe emphysema who required a portable oxygen tank to breathe. Pennington had recently lost his wife of 51 years and had moved in with his daughter Jean. Four generations of the family lived in the rented double-wide now. Jean quit her job flipping burgers and swirling soft serve at a local Dairy Queen to care for her father. The family was now entirely reliant on the $6.30 per hour her son-in-law earned making plastic safety glasses at the Mid-South Electric Company, one of the only employers in the area. The Pennington home was Clinton's first stop on a four-day tour. He went on to Clarksdale, Mississippi, and ended in Watts, California, with stops in East Lewis, Illinois, the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota, and a Phoenix, Arizona barrio. Like Tyner, these places had some of the highest rates of poverty in the nation. Like the Pennington family, residents suffered from health problems, unemployment, and a lack of adequate transportation and housing. It was the first and only time that Clinton would visit many of these communities during his presidency. His travel plans usually took him to the expansive mansions and office parks of Silicon Valley and the skyscrapers of Wall Street, the places that represented the success of his agenda to stimulate a new economy based in tech, finance, and real estate. First Lady Hillary Clinton, who had stayed behind in Washington, explained, "Ray Pennington's story should remind us that, although this has been a great time for America, not every American has benefited from our country's success. The administration aimed to target the people in places like Pennington and Appalachia that were being left behind by the forces of the new economy." This descriptor reinforced the administration's contention that these places were anomalies in the boom times of the late 1990s and evaded the fact that the poverty of their residents was in large part the result of the forces of the new economy, which Clinton helped to unleash. Clinton's trip drew immediate comparisons, both to Lyndon Johnson's visit to Appalachia in 1964 to build support for the war on poverty, and Robert Kennedy's high-profile poverty tours of Kentucky, the Mississippi Delta, Pine Ridge, and Watts in the mid-1960s. Clinton's conversation with Pennington evoked the iconic image of Johnson squatting on the porch of a rundown cabin in Inez, Kentucky, to talk with Tom Fletcher, surrounded by the eight children he supported on $400 per year. Clinton traversed much of the same ground as his Democratic predecessors, but his purpose was different. The Clinton tour aimed to do more than expose the problems of the other America. He wanted to draw attention to their profit-making potential. As Clinton explained during his 1999 State of the Union address, "Our greatest untapped markets are not overseas. They are right here at home. And we should go after them by building a bridge from Wall Street to Appalachia to the Mississippi Delta to our Native American communities." Clinton and his staff compared the New Markets Tour, as the four-day journey was called, to the trips they orchestrated for corporate executives throughout the 1990s to explore investment opportunities in emerging markets in Southeast Asia, Africa, and Latin America. For this so-called domestic trade mission, Clinton invited CEOs and representatives of several major corporations and financial institutions, including Bank of America, Citigroup, Aetna Insurance, Walgreens, and Fannie Mae. As Clinton explained to an audience in Appalachia, not far from the Pennington home, he was showing corporate leaders that they should take a look at investing in rural and inner city America. It's good for business, good for America's growth, and it's the right thing to do. Selling the New Markets program to Wall Street and Silicon Valley executives during the last 2 years of his presidency, Clinton would frequently tell them that it was a win-win and a way that they could do well by doing good. The tour marked the culmination of Clinton's enduring effort to promote private sector investment, market-based tools, and opportunity, rather than redistribution, government assistance, and economic security as the best route to address poverty, economic inequality, and racial segregation. As Clinton explained to an audience at a factory in Clarksdale, Mississippi, in the heart of the Delta, he had been cultivating this approach to poverty, economic growth, and governance since his time as a governor of neighboring Arkansas. In the 1980s, he invited Muhammad Yunus, the founder of the pioneering Bangladeshi microfinance organization, Grameen Bank, and Mary Houghton and Ron Griswinski of the Shore Bank Corporation, a community development bank based in Chicago, to set up a bank and micro-enterprise program in the Delta aimed at helping poor Black women on welfare become entrepreneurs. Clinton carried this model with him in his successful 1992 campaign for president as part of his quest to prove that he was a new kind of Democrat. Once in power, the Clinton administration implemented this market-based approach in its economic empowerment, international development and welfare, housing, and school reform efforts. These efforts crested at the end of Clinton's presidency with this attempt to bring capital investment to places like the Appalachian Hamlet, where Ray Pennington lived. Clinton was aided in this measure by many of the other figures who joined him on his journey to these so-called left-behind places. In addition to the corporate executives, Clinton was accompanied by cabinet secretaries like Andrew Cuomo, several members of Congress, Democratic Leadership Council, DLC, head Al Frome, and civil rights activist Reverend Jesse Jackson. It was fitting that Frome joined Clinton on tour, since the DLC played a critical role in shaping Clinton's market-based vision to poverty and governance. Frome and a group of Democratic politicians, including Clinton and Al Gore, founded the DLC in 1985 with the explicit goal of reinventing the party through a new electoral strategy and policy agenda. Calling themselves New Democrats, the DLC declared that Democrats should make it their fundamental mission to expand economic opportunity, not government, which would be achieved through free markets and free trade. They also called for introducing choice, competition, and market incentives into the public sector, and stressed that market-oriented solutions could encourage individual responsibility and empowerment among the poor. It was more jarring to see Jesse Jackson as a part of the entourage, scouting out new markets in economically distressed and racially segregated communities. The civil rights activist and two-time Democratic presidential candidate had served as the most prominent face and voice for the left wing of the Democratic Party for much of the previous two decades. Jackson had also been one of the most vocal critics of the New Democrats. He dismissed the DLC as Democrats for the leisure class and accused them of trying to suburbanize the Democratic Party. He had also routinely castigated Clinton for trading in race-baiting politics and ignoring marginalized groups, deeming his reforms to the welfare system as a war on the poor. By 1999, however, he had done an about-face and become one of the most enthusiastic participants on the New Markets tour, affirmatively celebrating how Clinton was launching a war for profits. Jackson's ringing endorsement symbolized how dominant the faith in market-based thinking had become by the end of the 1990s, and how much a progressive vision advocating equity and justice rather than opportunity, individual responsibility, and profits had diminished. Accounts of politics in the late 20th century have tended to focus on conservatives and the Republican Party. In this telling, a powerful coalition of right-wing business people and activists, used the economic and social chaos of the late 1960s and early 1970s as an opportunity to gain political power through the election of Ronald Reagan in 1980. Reagan's victory offered conservatives the chance to implement an agenda that combined free market, anti-government, socially conservative, and racially reactionary policies. These efforts became critical in destroying both the electoral coalition.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.